and welcome to another edition of the program. Today I'm privileged to share my space with a friend, a professional colleague, a father, a husband, a political commentator, because if you hear him on Facebook, on social media, he has a say to every topical issue affecting a great country, Nigeria. We will meet him after this time out. My name is Comfort Okorunkwo. We will take a break, and when we come back, it will be time to meet my guest, sharing my space on this edition of the program. So, don't go away.
If you travel around the world, you will find out that there is no place like Nigeria. Beautiful, peaceful, very warm and friendly climate all year round. Largest concentration of black people in the world. Hospitable, vibrant and happy people. There is no place like Nigeria. A land of opportunities. The biggest winner in the world of business and investments. Extremely rich in multicultural diversity. There is no place like Nigeria.
Nigeria, good people, great nation.
Hello and welcome to another edition of My Space.
My name is Maxwell Loco, Managing Director, NTA TV Enterprises. Watch My Space on ABN TV channel 15.9 History.
Welcome back. The program is My Space, and I'm privileged to share the space with a former colleague, a political commentator, a father, a mother, a father, a friend, and someone who is passionate about music. Join me in welcoming on this edition of My Space, Boyega Adelaja. Welcome to the program.
Thank you very much, Paul.
It's nice to have you. After a series of calls and appointments, finally you're here.
Yes.
And I'm glad to have you on this edition of the program, My Space on ABN TV, channel 15.9, Houston, Texas.
Yeah.
All right. I did not prepare to ask this first question, but because of the recent happening, I must ask it, because I'm a woman. As a man, what is your take on the rejection of the Gender and Equal Opportunity Bill by the Senate? So many people have reacted to this bill being thrown away by the Senate. So what's your take on it?
It wasn't, to be honest with you, it wasn't a surprise, because I look at some of our lawmakers, I look at them as being male chauvinists, or what would you put, I mean, how would you put it? You know, they are men, and generally even in Africa, you know, men seem to want to dominate women. They believe that the role of the women is always in the kitchen. I mean, they have to, well, you know, take care of the children and stuff like that. But women in Nigeria have come of age. You know, a lot of women are doing fantastic things in their profession. So, but when I wasn't surprised when they threw it out, and I expected Nigerian women to
rise up
against that, because nobody's going to fight the fight for them. But I think the reason it was thrown out for the house, you know, out of the window, is because of the nature of the African man. You know,
but we have women in the Senate.
Yeah, we do. But even the women in the Senate,
they don't have a say.
They do. They have a say, but they are not as vocal as the men.
Okay.
You know, it's like me asking, when are we going to have the first female president in Nigeria? Women are sort of meticulous. They take care of the home, they take care of business, so I don't see any reason why God created all of us equally. Yeah. The only thing that is different is the ribs. Mm-hmm. You know, the woman has 7 ribs and the man has 9. The man has 9. The female has female reproductive organs and male has male reproductive. That is the only thing. These are the 2 things that are different. We have 2 eyes, 1 nose, 2 ears. You know, we are human beings. We were created equally, really. In India, Indira Gandhi was the Prime Minister of India. A woman is the Prime Minister in Germany. Mm-hmm. You know, women, I think maybe over time, our politicians, male politicians, will begin to have different impression about women. And the women themselves, they should come out, they should protest. I will support them.
I will see a revolution of women.
Yes, I will support the women because we came out of a woman. Even mm-hmm. the man came out of a woman. You know, so you know, I think our lawmakers should have a rethink and see what they can do. If there are areas of the bill that they think should be modified, you know, but if you not just throw it out,
completely.
It's not fair on women. If I was a woman. Any senator that does that, when he comes on, I will not cook for him.
Okay, all right. So, I'd like to know, who is Gboyega Adelaja? Tell us about Gboyega Adelaja.
Well, I was 64 2 days ago, 64 years. I was born on the 19th of March, 1952, to Venerable and Mrs. My father, you know, passed on in 2001. He was the Archdeacon of Lagos. He was an educationist. You know, my mother, you know, I come from a very religious family, and we were born. I was born in Lagos in 1952, like I said, and I attended St. Peter's Antiayo Primary School, kindergarten. Sorry, St. Peter's Primary School, Faji. I don't like people who are lazy, you know, because I try to do things very well. You know, anything that I have to do, I'm a very honest person. This man you have seen here, I'm honest. You know, I know that. I can say that about myself. And, you know, I think
we are... Let's say you have your integrity intact.
Yes, of course. Yes. Of course, you know, I mean, you know now, comfort when we were all working at
that time.
More than 20 years ago. We've come a long way.
More than 30 years ago.
We've come a long way, and you know the kind of discipline
we had then,
and then, you know. But that's why I'm always angry when I read about corruption and how some of our trusted administrators, people who are put there to look after public funds, how they embezzle. It seems they steal this fund. They don't have a conscience at all. You know, imagine somebody stealing pension money that is meant for people who have retirees. And how do they feel? They go to churches, they go to mosque, they are the people they know them in the church, they donate in the church. You know what I mean? So I am I don't know. I think I'm a very fair person, to be honest with you.
You are a musician. You have played with some of the great artists from this continent. Tell us your experience.
My musical interest, I would say, started from when I was young in primary school, because I had an uncle, my father's younger brother. He had a piano in the house, and each time we went to his house, he was the inspector of tax in the Western region then. Uncle Fred, you know, he had a piano in his house, and when we went to his house for holidays, he woke us up in the morning for prayers, everybody in the house. And then he plays the African hymn. So I used to admire him, go when he's swinging his head like that and he's playing. I used to admire him, so that was how I initially started to have interest in music. So, but when I now got into secondary school, you know, I found out that we had a musical band. So I said, oh, this would be an opportunity for me
to learn.
And of course, we had music teacher, Papa Bankole, late Papa Bankole. Mr. John, who taught me how to play saxophone, not even the keyboard. And Baba Kwali taught us how to play the keyboard, I mean music and all that. So, but I took interest in music in secondary school, and we had a school band called the Canons. Just like so many other secondary schools also had bands, you know, I was playing the keyboards there, and you know, but I listened to different kinds of music from secondary school, the Beatles, Hendrix and all that. So by the time I had the opportunity to travel to the US for my university education, I took a higher interest in music. Because you know, America encourages you, if you want, if you are good in something,
just go for it.
Go for it, you know. And then some friends, late Glenn Warren, Guy Warren's son, Guy Warren is a drummer from Ghana. Yo Opoku or Krema Asante, late Stanley Todd, Stanley and Frankie Todd, they are late now, they are brothers. We started to a band. Because when we went to a function, Nigerian embassy function, they didn't have a band. So, and I said, look, if we have
an opportunity,
so we got ourselves together and we started rehearsing. That was how we started playing in DC. And the band was so good that Hugh Masekela heard about the band, you know, and he wanted to go on tour. And he came to Washington, D.C. and, you know, came and saw the met with the band. And he said, well, this is the kind of
people you want to work with.
So that was how the musical journey started. You know, we traveled all over the U.S. You know, we traveled from east to west. Orlando Julius was on the band with us. Yes, Olabi Julius and some Ghanaians. Me and Olabi Julius were the two Nigerians at the time. And that was how we toured for almost 4 years. You know, went all over this, you know, played in some, like Carnegie Hall, played in very nice places. And we recorded 3 albums with him. So, but when I came back home in 1977, you know, I also played music with so many people on their albums. I remember Adelia Biodun, Shegun Adewale, Shino Peters, actually before Shino Peters broke away from him, played with Oliver the Coke, Onyeka, you know, we did a lot
did
of...
Did you play with Sonny Ade and Ebenezer Obey?
No, but Sonny Ade is my personal friend.
Okay.
Because we started P-Man together in his club, Aria Nightclub, I think in 1981 or 1982, you know. Used to meet in the club, you know, some late Sonny Okosun, Sonny Ade, late Bobby Benson, late Bala Miller. You know, we started P-Man. In fact, I was the first secretary, pro tem secretary of P-Man. Yes, before Ima Obosi took over from me. And then, I mean, you see, can see how.
What was the experience like?
I mean, that gave me an opportunity to travel through the length and breadth of the United States. That was how from the most East Coast.
To the West Coast?
To the West, to mid states like Illinois, Chicago, Tennessee. You know, we traveled. We covered almost all the 50 states.
Just in America?
Oh, yeah. For 3 years, we were on the road. And it was a professional band. I mean, we were playing for audiences of 50,000, 60,000 people, big stadium, big sound system, jazz club, like Troubadour in Philadelphia. In Hollywood, you had I can't remember now, I think I'm getting a bit older now. But we were playing in the jazz, you know, America now, you meet to Houston and all that. You have very big standard of music in the sense that bands were always touring. You know, that's one thing we don't have in Nigeria.
After going through all the tours and performances, how would you rate the entertainment industry of Nigeria?
The entertainment industry has come of age, but it is not perfect yet. Nothing in our country is perfect. It might be functional, like NEPA is not perfect. As we are in the studio now, they take the light. So, but you're asking me how would I rate the music industry? I mean, look at some of our musicians, the Wizkid, Two Face, they are making good money, and Nigerian music is taking over the world. Some people laid the foundation. Okay, those are performing artists or recording artists. But if I want to talk about performing artists, you know, I was going to say that in America, You have bands, different bands, jazz bands and all that. If they are in the state of Pennsylvania, maybe if they play in New York today for 3 days, 4 days, you will see that they will go to another town. From that town, they go. The musicians are traveling. But in Nigeria, go to Pianoba, the transport building, is the same people you will. You know, why can't they move from that place to another place and rotate?
So what do you think is responsible for this stagnation?
It is the organization. You know, we know, you know the American, the music industry in America, it is well organized.
Dynamic.
You have promoters, you have managers, you know, just like footballers in Europe, all over the world, they move from one club to the other, you know, at the end of the season, if you want to trade. So it should be like that for musicians. You come to Abuja, the same band that is playing in club, they will be there for, after a while you get bored. They are supposed to move from where they are to Gwaripa. So somewhere in Gwaripa, the one in Gwaripa should come here. They should move, rotate. That is how entertainment is done. But because they look at musicians as people who are begging for money, or but in America, some of the richest people in America
are musicians.
Musicians. You know, so it's an easy way.
People in the show business.
In the show business, yes. And it's the way the musicians here carry themselves. You know, but I think, you know, it will go through a transformation and it will be better. But as far as the recording artists are concerned, it is getting better. You know, technology too has helped in the sense that, you know, people have studios, musicians, recording artists have studios like Don Jazzy, they all have studios in their home. So when they have,
like,
I have my studio. Once I have an idea, I go to the studio and put it down because it's all creative. Mm-hmm. You know, you can develop it into something else that then people can enjoy and maybe teach them one or two lessons.
So, what motivates you?
When I see beautiful faces like you, I'm motivated.
Oh, pull the other leg. what motivates you?
I think I see a lot when I see a lot of people, you know, that equality, people are being marginalized because some other people who are in a position to make sure that their lives are better. The same thing we were talking about when somebody will steal billions of naira or dollars that is supposed to be pumped into the society that doesn't really belong to them, so that the lives of people can improve. You know, and one person will then steal all the money out there. You see, when I see people, I get a lot of inspiration. And I mix with a lot of people, you know, ordinary people. My organizer, if I was talking with my mechanic, you would think maybe we are in the same category. You know, I learn from them, because you interact with these people and they inspire me a lot. I think things around me inspire me to, you know, to do the things I do as far as music is concerned, or television or something.
Do you have a role model? Who is your role model?
Well, I would say my late father was my role model. You know, he was the retired architect, and he was principal of the CNS Grammar School, the oldest secondary school in Nigeria, for almost 20 years. My late father was my role model because he was a complete man. You know, he was.
He influenced you.
Yeah, he was a man of very good character, very high moral values. You know, and you know, I wish, but his shoes are too big for me. He is a church person, but I am an artist, a creative artist. But I learned a lot of lessons about life from him. In fact, I would say my role models were my parents, my late mother, and my late father.
Well, years gone by,
yeah.
Parents were not really happy when their children wanted to deviate from being a doctor, maybe an architect. Did it happen to you too?
He did. I traveled to America to read architecture at Howard University.
Just as Fela traveled to read medicine and eventually became...
You know, the architecture, we had some modules, some subjects I was very good with the creative part of
the architecture,
design elements and stuff, but it was the mathematics or calculus and all those things. I never passed those things because I never understood. I mean, after a while, I lost interest and I went and read to Columbia School of Broadcasting. How did you take it? Well, I had to tell my parents that I'm not doing too well in all this mathematics and all that. It's just not my line. I would have loved to be an architect, you know, because I love to beautiful design. House, design, I love to do. But what I miss in being a creative architect, it's also good in music, you know. I mean, what I do, music, you know, and in television production, you know, documentaries and stuff like that. So it's still the same, you know, same pot to say, you know, but I don't know.
When you were in NTA, NTA was regarded as the best television broadcasting station then.
Yes.
People say NTA has lost its glory. What's your take on this?
Yeah, because most of most of government institutions lose their glory, you know, and you know the reason why, you know, people think that government institutions are places where you go and, you know,
acquire wealth and steal money
and do all kinds. They still do their work, you know, but they don't take it as their own. I mean, look at channels. It's not, NTA is supposed to be the biggest network, but to be honest with you, I worked in NTA, you know, with 79, we all worked there. I think I spent about a year or two before I pulled out. You know, and I see it is typical. Where is Nigeria Airways today? Nigeria Airways used to have more than 30 aircrafts flying all over the world. Because where is Nigeria National Shipping Line? They have so many ships. These are government institutions that were run down by Nigerians themselves. You know, so I believe that if NTA was privatized, you know, it could do better. You know, it could do better if NTA was privatized. I mean, look at China, look at John Momo. We all worked in NTA together in those days. He read news and we were in production department and all that. But he's running his TV station. He has to run it profitably, you know. And
his TV station has won best TV station for more than nine, 10 years now.
So I think NTA should be privatized so that, you know, when it is being run by private individuals who have to make profit, then I'm sure the staff themselves are very serious, you know. But when it starts, you know, I'm just here, when my retirement is this nonchalant, like I said, the lackadaisical attitude and all that, you know, that happens in all government institutions, you know. So, you know, but I think that is what can save NTA if government can sell it, because government has invested a lot of money into NTA itself. Look at all the networks, all the TV stations. Some are run down, some are not functional anymore, some are still functional, you know, but
epileptic.
Government can sell and still make money and still have a hold in NTA, but let it belong to Nigerians, people who can invest their money.